Welcome to Home Academy, publisher of courses on audio CD. You are about to listen to a Home Academy course in the series Religion and Philosophy. Political Philosophy, an audio course on Western political theory by Grahame Lock. Professor Grahame Lock teaches political philosophy at Nijmegen and Leiden universities, and also lectures in European philosophy at Oxford University. Among his publications are works on political theory and on general philosophy, including textbooks on the history of political ideas and a monograph on Wittgenstein. This audio course on political philosophy consists of four CDs and is divided into 12 lectures of approximately 20 minutes each. Lecture 1. Plato. The Beginnings. Justice and the Philosopher Kings.
Well, before I actually begin to talk about the topic, and it was good for me to prepare this because this is really classical stuff. And often in our jobs, we kind of are trying to apply the whole time, and we kind of assume that we know what Plato said or what Aristotle said, etc. And then we forget that we don't know any longer, that we didn't look at the texts for a long time. So I did look again at the texts and tried to make sense of them. And so I'll try to make sense for you today of what I made sense of. You may agree, you may disagree, you may say that doesn't make sense to me, because things which make sense don't necessarily make sense to people. So I'm going to begin with my first topic. I just go in chronological order, in fact, because I'm going to begin with Plato, and Plato is very, very old political theory. At the same time, it's often said that all philosophy since Plato is a footnote to Plato. And if that's so, one question which arises is why? How is that possible? I mean, if you compare philosophy with, say, the exact sciences, medicine, and so on, you wouldn't very easily find a student of physics or of chemistry or of biology or of mathematics, even mathematics, let alone medicine, say, well, nothing much has been produced in the last 2,000 years which surpasses what the ancient Greeks knew. On the contrary, these students buy a new textbook every year, and I say, especially in medicine, because in medicine, you know, the 2006 textbook would be of no use next year. You'll have to throw it away and get a 2007 textbook. So quickly does knowledge progress. And yet, in the field of philosophy, strangely enough, nothing seems to happen, except that people reflect again and again on the old texts. They reflect again and again on the old texts, and in reflecting, produce new knowledge, I suppose. Or is it just old knowledge recycled? These are some of the questions which for us are important. So why study the ancients? Why study Plato? Why study Aristotle? Why study other thinkers of the ancient world? Aren't they out of date? Presumably not. One advantage in reading the ancients is that it helps us to take a distance from fashions in ideas. We forget today's newspaper and we go back and we look at old works which present the world in a very different context from the context in which we normally see it. The very categories, the structures of thought are very different. For example, in the Athens of the time of Plato. Plato was born 427 BC, died 347 BC before Christ. Of course, he didn't know it at the time. Nobody knew it at the time. They had a different manner of counting the years. But for us, it's BC. That means, for example, that it's interesting for us to realize that when Platonic philosophical ideas were taken up by the Christians, they were taking up something which was pagan. That's very interesting because the Christians found in Plato many elements which came in useful. Later on, I'll talk about St. Augustine, who was a kind of Platonist. He got many of his ideas from Plato. For instance, but we'll come back to that, for instance, the idea of evil. Well, my criterion for choosing thinkers and my criterion for discussing particular aspects of these thinkers is not so much the influence of their ideas as whatever justified influence these ideas might have. There are thinkers who have a lot of influence, but whose ideas are actually second rate. And maybe in some cases they have a lot of influence because their ideas are second rate. My mother-in-law once asked me, why don't you write bestsellers instead of books on philosophy? By definition, bestsellers sell better. I tried, and it's very hard. It's very hard to, you know, reach that level, whether reaching that level means going up or going down. I couldn't be Lord Archer. I don't know if you know Lord Archer, a rather well-known politician, ex-politician, I should say, writer of sex and shopping novels, and indeed one-time inhabitant of one of Her Majesty's prisons. He can do that kind of thing, and his ideas have a certain influence on quite a lot of people. That, as I said, is not my criterion, nor am I doing history of ideas. History of ideas is a kind of history. It looks at what ideas were important, influential in a social context at a given time. And again, some ideas which were socially, politically influential are intellectually not important. What we're not talking about is therefore the causal history of influence. Who was influenced by what? Now and again, maybe I'll say, well, certain ideas did inspire other thinkers. I just said it when I mentioned, for example, the influence of Plato on St. Augustine. But that's not the primary aspect of the attempt to understand ideas. What we're trying to understand is what somebody said, whether it's interesting, and whether it's true. Although the last bit is controversial. Very, very difficult in philosophy ever to prove that anything is true. It's sometimes possible to prove that something is false because it's incoherent, because it's self-contradictory. And that's, of course, a sure sign that there's something wrong with an idea. But to prove that an idea is true, very much more difficult. Well, I'll zoom in now on Plato's Athens. As you will remember, Athens was, if not a unique example, nevertheless a rather rare example in the ancient world of a kind of democracy. Of course, it was a special sort of democracy. It was a democracy of all free men. All free men, a minority of the population, which meant, as a matter of fact, men with some degree of property. One of the criteria for being free in these times was that you owned a certain amount of property. No women, therefore. No foreigners. No slaves. Of course, no children. These were not part of the decision-making structures of Athenian society. But there was a kind of democracy among the free men. How many were there, just to get a picture? Well, there are different estimates, but one estimate is that there were about 20,000 citizens, free men, who were part of the decision-making structures. Plato, living in this first democracy, is often called the first great political philosopher, the great political theorist, and he was against democracy. He was a critic of democracy. He was an enemy of democracy. So here we have a first paradox. Here we have a first paradox of political theory, yeah? That the first democracy known to us, Athens, is also the home city of the first great enemy of democracy. And of course, at this moment, some of you, having grown up in a democratic society, may be thinking, well, I'm not very sympathetic to this approach, to this anti-democratic approach. We're going to hear what Plato did wrong. How did he come to draw this unfortunate conclusion that democracy is a bad thing? But I'm not going to help you draw that conclusion. I'm going to present Plato's arguments.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.